For 500 years, they have waited for this day.
There can be only one.
They're here.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Royale, the podcast where we talk about movies as bros. Yes, the brotherhood of cinema. Welcome to this episode. I'm Mike Mixtape, your host. Let me introduce you to my bros of cinema here, including our honorary bro. Oh, I can't even say that word. Holy crap.
I'd love to be an honorary bro.
You are tonight, baby.
Yes.
We're all about bros tonight. Bros talking about films. It's all good. Tonight's topic, before I introduce the guys, is fantasy films. So get your fantasy films in motion in your head. Fantasy Film Friday, hashtag. First up, we got Matt Bernayos, known as Animat.
Hey, guys! Well, I'm pretty much full of energy tonight. This bro just went out and jumped around on trampolines for an hour, so I'm ready for anything fantasy.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed. Next up, next to Matt, is James Sullivan, also known as Hymitude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by Liquid Skype, the one thing that will keep your laptop going.
Mmm, delicious.
Mmm. Delicious. Mmm, get a warm glass.
Taste that blue.
Tastes like internet problems.
Exactly. Tastes like glitches.
Glitch!
Mm. And our honorary bro tonight is a fame bit player and the Nostalgia Critic. He's played the Devil, Black Willy Wonka, many characters. He's done voice acting. He's Malcolm Ray.
Hello, everybody. I'm glad to be an honorary bro before honorary hoes. So, we're just gonna...
No problem.
Keep this lit. And, I'm ready when you are.
Yeah. Talk about fantasy films tonight, and fantasy films are kind of different. Like, you have your sci-fis, you have your actions. Fantasy films, it takes on an epic adventure, and adventure films are a different topic in general, but fantasy has, like, elements of a lot of things. There's a lot of subgenres out there. Typical ones are, like, sword and sorcery, you know, but there's other kinds of fantasy films out there that you could just go into. There's plenty to talk about when it comes to fantasy. Questionable ones tonight, yes. But we'll get into that. Very questionable ones.
Yeah. Oh, are we gonna get to that? Oh,
we are getting into that. We'll, I decided to keep that.
Yes.
I think it's a good topic to discuss.
It is. These guys were, like, debating on Facebook. It was, like,
we had a legit gentleman's argument about it.
Good.
Yes. We're gonna recreate that.
Reenact it. Yes. So, I'll start off first. I'll get the ball rolling here. My film I chose was a film that features, like, immortality. Immortality is a very fantasy kind of element where it's never gonna happen in real life. I mean, who's gonna be immortal? I mean, Highlander is the prime example of that, from 1986.
Highlander.
It's a contemporary fantasy film, as you will. It's not a typical fantasy film, but it's contemporary. It basically tells the story of Conor McLeod, who, he's a Scotland Highlander, you know, he was in the Scottish clan, you know. He became immortal. He trained in sword fighting, you know, and he's among immortals, where there's a game where they have to slice and behead people, and there can only be one.
Mm-hmm. And about five sequels, but go on.
Oh god, those sequels, oh god. But yeah, the original one is, like, it has a quite a big cult following, and it's interesting how it takes the fantasy elements you think of and just makes it contemporary, because it's set in 1985 in New York, I believe, so you see all the sword fighting in, like, parking garages and using katanas and swords, and it's just, I like that mix of blending of, because I'm not a huge fan of fantasy films. Like, I can understand, you know, the sorcery of the wizards and then the swords of, you know, the golden days of, like, medieval times or something like that. That's what I think of when it comes to fantasy. Highlander, on the other hand, you know, it mixes those elements with contemporary elements. Mm-hmm. And you kind of go... Connor McCloud, played by Christopher Lambert, they flash back to Scotland days and different eras when he was immortal. And immortality is kind of different because you live forever and people that you love die, and it's kind of sad you'd be alone forever kind of thing, which kind of sucks.
Yeah, but once you come to the end of it all, once you come to the end of the game and you're the only immortal left, you are blessed with two gifts.
Because if you defeated all the immortals, you know, you get the prize, and which is like the prize in this like game of immortals is like gather all the information from previous like immortals that all the other immortals killed. So you get access amount of knowledge of the past, and you know you're smart and all that stuff.
You're smart and all that. Yep. Uh-huh.
You're smart and y'all.
Edumacation.
Edumacation.
But you also become mortal. Or did they... Or did they establish that?
The film, it kind of... Because... It's interesting, because... This sets up the rules for immortality and... You know, in media in general, like, this is, like, no other film or anything else set up immortality as for rules. Like, in this film, they set up, like, I don't think he comes mortal, he's still immortal, I believe. Like, he's the ultimate immortal person. Like, because I talked about the sequel in a previous episode, and god darn, that is a bad movie. Oh, bad taste. Like, I don't want to talk about that movie, but I think with this movie, they just established that he's still immortal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a bit confusing on whether or not mortal, immortal. Yeah, see, the whole concept of fantasy is, you know, a grasp of something that is beyond our comprehension of realism. And that's why in so many cases, like, you know, Star Wars, science fiction and fantasy blend so well.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because science fiction inherently is fantasy.
Right. There could be some could be like that, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, essentially it is. I want to save a lot of my points for when we get to my film. So don't mind me if I'm being quiet, because...
No, it's totally understandable. You can get to learn about other films.
Yeah.
The cool thing about Highlander is that all, you know, the production... I read all the trivia in the world, so I read the behind-the-scenes stuff, how they make it, so... There's, like, sword fighting in this film. It's amazing choreographed sword fighting. And they hit each other's swords, and you see sparks.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's beautiful sparks. They go, psh, psh, psh. It's like, ugh. But what they did with that is that they hooked up a car battery to the swords. So as they cling, cling, it sparked.
Nice.
One person had the positive side, and one had the negative side. So it was like, psh, psh. It was like...
Mm-hmm.
It was...
So and they were...
Actors were still safe.
Yeah, they were...
They had gloves on. They were like trying to hide it so they were safe. But it was, like, so cool that it made that effect work.
I think some of what I heard was they got minor shocks in the process, but it wasn't anything major.
Probably. Yeah. You have, let's see, like I said, Christopher Lambert plays Connor McCloud. He had to learn how to speak English for this film. Like, he had no, like, he doesn't speak English. He had to go through a vocal coach, you know, to speak the language. So it was his first English-speaking role. His other role before that was Greystroke, the Tarzan of the Apes, where he played Tarzan and he was like with grunts and a few words.
Ah, Tarzan, that has a movie coming up too.
Yes, oh. Legend of Tarzan.
Oh yeah, that's right. I forgot about
coming up.
Apparently, it's gonna be a next sequel, year. I believe.
Sort of. Legend of Tarzan will probably it's gonna have like a few years after.
Yes.
Because that's it's Wibbly Wobbly.
It's like Alice in Wonderland in a sense.
Yeah, that's true. It's just something different. You have Sean Connery in this film in Highlander. He plays. This is really confusing. He plays a Egyptian. Yeah, he's Scottish in real life.
Interesting.
It's very. He's all tanned, and he's a Spaniard too. He's from Spain too. So he's an Egyptian who's from Spain, and his accent is all. I mean, it's not. It's so weird for him. For coming onto this film, it's just like, I'm here to teach you the ways of immortality. Okay, that was a bad, bad impression.
I'm here to teach you the ways of immortality.
Wait, is this Walken or like Sean Connery?
No, we could do different Walkens if you want.
Step aside, fellas. Let me tell you exactly on how to be immortal. You see, it's going to be very simple. All you need is to find an Egyptian man who lives in Spain, yet somehow he has a Scottish accent.
Yeah.
It's confusing, I know.
This was just the bad guy in the film's career. Continue, sorry.
Right. And it's weird because this is the second he appeared in the sequel too. So this is like the second role he's done twice, more than once, besides James Bond. So it's something to know. The bad guy, the Kurgan, he's the one that Connor McLeod fights at the end. He's played by Clancy Brown, and you may know Clancy Brown for his voice work later on. He played Mr. Krabs in SpongeBob.
Oh, that is true. Oh my God.
I know, it's weird when you think of early roles and you hear Mr. Krabs' voice and it's like, wait, this is a guy who played a bad guy in the 80s. he's all bald, he's tall, and he's just got that thick, deep voice. Ready to kick some butt.
Oh yeah, that guy, Well, why would you be surprised at all to hear that voice in the cartoon? He's practically a cartoon character based on that description.
Yeah.
His character in the film, the Kurgan, he is definitely crazy. Like, there's a church scene. They had to get permission to film the film in a church from the priest, and there was no script for that scene. It was like improvised by Clancy Brown. So he was like saying stuff, and they're just sitting there like, oh my god, amen. Because they were like, he was saying a lot of crazy stuff in that scene. I can't remember what the exact words are, but it was like,
isn't one of them hilarious. Is like Happy Halloween at one point?
Something like that. Oh my god, it's one of the best roles that Clancy Brown's done. So that's funny.
As a SpongeBob fan, that is a lie.
Then he turns around and at one point he quotes. He quotes Rock of Ages as better to burn out than fade away.
Yes, that was that was the line, better to fade away, and he just walks off. But the big thing about Highlander besides the film is the soundtrack by Queen.
Yes.
Oh god.
If there's
Freddie Mercury.
Yeah, if there's something that you need, if there's something that you're definitely going to get out of this film, it's the soundtrack. It's one of those movies.
It's like the best soundtracks you'll ever hear. Queen knows what they're doing. Like, they done it with Flash Gordon. Now they can do it with Highlander. It's really good.
Although this could be a controversial thing to say, but in this day and age, which one would you say is more popular now? The soundtrack by Queen or Highlander itself?
The film, see, that's the thing. It's, I don't hear a lot of Queen fans saying, oh, Highlander soundtrack is like the best thing ever. They don't say that. I mean, I've heard people talk about Highlander as a cult following. It's just, it's got a bit, like, people don't discuss Queen that much, around me at least, so I don't, like, Prince of the Universe, the theme for the Highlander, it's probably one of the better Queen songs I've heard. It's actually in my ringtone, actually.
Here we are, born to be kings, we're the princes of the universe. You're throwing me off, Matt. I'm trying to impress Malcolm.
Oh.
This is my singing.
Hey.
Mediocre. Never mind.
Okay, so I might be a fan.
Mediocre. You guys are making me hungry for okra now.
Who gets hungry for okra?
Food?
Yes, okra. Fried okra, specifically. Anyway.
I'm thinking okra from the Dark Crystal. No. Anyway, we were going on Highlander.
I know. This is hilarious. I love it. Highlander. This film launched a whole franchise. You had Highlander 2: The Quickening, which is probably the worst film in the franchise. You had Highlander 3: The Final Dimension, which is actually a better movie than the sequel. You can just skip the second movie and go to the third one. You had Highlander Endgame. Oh my god, Highlander Endgame. Ooh. James and I watched that and it was like, ooh.
Yeah. I remember. I have a story to tell about last night. And for the record, I just think that I think that Highlander as a film is okay in terms of everything. Right. Before I tell everyone the story about that.
All right.
Mike and I hopped on the Skype last night to watch a movie together, and there was a bit of miscommunication between us. He thought I was on there to watch Highlander with him, and I said to him, at what point after last time do you think I would ever want to come on Skype again and watch Highlander with you? Yes.
I mean, I guess the experience of Endgame kind of ruined him.
Yes.
My god. It's, if you're into immortality, if you're interested in seeing a contemporary fantasy film, Highlander is definitely the one you need to go into, especially for the sword fighting too and the soundtrack. It's the meshing of it all, plus the, you know, the cinematography and the directing effort of Russell, what was his name? God, I can't remember the director's name, but the director's very good because he worked on music videos in the past. He's really good, so Highlander is definitely a movie you should check out sometime.
Yeah, dude, check it out.
Yeah, I'll have to check it out too. I keep hearing a lot about it.
A lot of people talk about it. It's a cult following. It's from Highlander, let's go into a little bit of 2000s era of fantasy film via James, via Bridget Terabithia.
Ah, that movie.
Yes!
You know, that's an interesting... So that's classified as fantasy?
I would definitely classify it as fantasy because even though it deals with the imagination mainly as its venue for fantasy.
True.
It's still a depiction, you know, of very otherworldly events, which fantasy tends to show. And I wanted to bring it up because, yeah, I did like the movie. I did like it. And interesting enough, I wanted to bring it up because it comes from a book that is not fantasy.
Right.
And so you're kind of thinking, well, how does that work? Well, The premise of the film is two kids, a young guy and a young girl, their middle school age, become fast friends once her family moves in into town, and it's some podunk town, farm town area. I don't think they really established where it was. But, they move in, she's his new next door neighbor, and, she's really into fantasy, so they're hanging out one day, and they decide to create this fantasy world in the woods in the area in their backyard. And the film goes about documenting the epic events that occur in their little fantasy bouts, which is very interesting, because even though we know this is fantasy, we know this is make-believe, we know this is two kids just playing with each other, my goodness, for me personally, it hit sort of a chord, because I remember doing this sort of thing back when I was around that age, you know, trying to use my imagination to face or just not face anything, but to just sort of dive out of reality. And the interesting way that they use fantasy and imagination in the aspect of this film is they use it as character building. If you follow these kids to school, you find out they deal with bullies at school, that sometimes in some cases they're a little bit much to deal with. They're not the most threatening bullies, to be honest with you, but there comes a point where they're deep into their adventure phase, and I think it's Leslie, the girl, says to Jess, the guy, you can fight off this and you can fight off that, but you can't stand up against the bully. And it was kind of an interesting, it has its own way of bridging the gap between imagination and reality. And the way that the film deals with that, I find it admirable.
Yeah, I mean, it's attempts at it. Like, I totally understand the concept. Whether or not it achieved that, I kind of debate that it did, but it is admirable that it at least attempted to achieve that concept of, you know, showing what, you know, is happening, you know, in reality, and how it's seen in the eyes of these children experiencing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the now if you if you're crazy like me, you'll go as far as to compare this to the book that it came from, and you'll be surprised to know this. Mm-hmm. Like I said, there is the book is not a fantasy. The kids do go into the woods, and they have little moments of fantasy where they pretend sword fight and whatnot, and they write out in the book saying, oh, they created this imaginary world, but they don't ever tell you. They don't ever tell any stories about what happens in their imagination. instead, the book is trying to be a very deadpan portrait of what childhood is. And in some ways, it achieved that, but it's also far less interesting without anything happening, without any major conflicts, whether or not they're imagined or not. I mean, there's chapters that go by where it's just a portrait of Jess and Leslie having Christmas, and that's like the whole chapter. And I'm thinking, wow, my goodness, imagine all the swarms of fairies that could be fighting about this time. Imagine the giants that could be walking through the woods. It felt a little bit underwhelming, but there's also something I find quite amusing when I read the book, and that's regarding the character of Leslie. They establish that she's in the film, they make her this really cute kid, you know, blonde, played by Anna Sophia Robb. In the film, she's a total geek and a bookworm. She's not an athlete or anything. She's into fantasy books, and she likes the Narnia books.
Wow.
Yes. Yeah, so so when they're coming up with a name, she says, you know, we could have our own. In the book, the way that they come up with the name, coming up with this imaginary world, they say, we could make up our own imaginary place in this forest, you know, like Narnia and such. That's pretty much her exact words. She's like, okay, let's do some Narnia stuff back in the backyard. And that's kind of funny, because that's what some people were actually criticizing the film about, saying that it was taking a thought-provoking children's book and trying to make it look like an epic fantasy, which it was not. As a matter of fact, now that I'm thinking about it, let me show you something.
Oh boy. Yeah, if only, honestly, since it's weird saying this now, but I actually only seen the Nostalgia Critic episode on Bridge to Terabithia.
Yes.
So that's my only frame of point of seeing the film. I didn't research it for this podcast, so...
Yeah, same here, honestly. I can only think of that rope.
Yeah, like, I've read the book, and then I've seen the film, and it's such a stark contrast. It's interesting.
It is. It's.
But it's funny to mention that James said that apparently Bridge to Terramythia, like the book, made a lot of references to Narnia. If it weren't for that controversial deal that happened, like with the movies, I can imagine Disney doing the same thing in the movie itself, like actually having elements of Narnia into it, since the first two movies. Like, they were from Disney, but then suddenly complications happen and they have to move Narnia to Fox. But, like, if they still had Narnia, I can imagine those little elements here and there in Bridge to Terramythia, like, or Terabithia or something like that. But, like, you know, have little cameos of, like, suddenly Aslan is there or something like that.
Like, I have the... Sorry, go on.
Like, it's just something that when you really think about it, it seems weird, but it doesn't sound as crazy as it sounds.
Well, you might be pretty close. And matter of fact, I have the Narnia books right here.
Mm.
And what do they have in the back here? A little map. Let's take a nice close look at this thing. We have Narnia, Archenland, Kellerman, more Narnia, the Great Eastern Ocean, the Bight of Kellerman, all these established areas that we see in the books and even in the films, the Lone Islands. What is the name of this island right here?
I highly doubt we could see that, but
you can't really see it very well here, but it says Terebinthia.
Wow.
Really? So it's just one continent away from being the book and story that we've known, that we've come to know and love?
Yes, they just took out an N. That's all they did was... Well, no wonder she was such a big fan of Narnia.
Yeah, really. I was about to say, like, if that's the case, I don't know if this is a dumb question, but would there be some people debating if Richard of Terabithia would be, like, a spinoff or a spiritual successor to Narnia?
I doubt it, because like all this stuff is supposed to be happening in the girl's head, right?
Okay, maybe.
Well, yeah, that's true also, and furthermore, when writing the book, the author of Bridge to Terabithia didn't quite have a full thought out idea for it, and what happened was her son was a real little at the time, 7-8 years old. He had a friend who was a girl who he was actually playing with at the time, and the girl died in a shipwreck in real life. And so, spoiler alert for those who haven't seen the film or read the book Bridge to Terabithia, yes, the girl Leslie dies as soon as the third act comes into play in an accident. Same way in the book and in the film, she gets in a rope swing accident. And the reason why she put it in there was because she wanted to help her own son come to terms with losing a friend like that. And so that's why the book and the movie was so important to him, or the family. So and that's why I still hold a lot of respect for the film, because they took liberties, but these were liberties that were acceptable. When they keep in the heart of the story that makes it important, when they keep in the stuff that makes it important, you can't really argue against the film and how it depicts that. In fact, but there is one case where you can argue against it, and that's this.
Ooh.
The PBS movie, television movie.
I can't see it.
The PBS 1985 Bridge to Terabithia.
Oh.
Less than an hour long, tries to go very direct from the book, and the family of the author do not like to talk about this because of it's kind of cheap and embarrassing. But when they try to pull off, I remember when I saw the scene in the film where Jesse's parents are trying to tell him your friend Leslie's dead. That was sort of a, for me, that was a sort of a shocker moment in my seat. I felt like my guts dropped just a little bit inside. I was like, holy shit, they went there. And the acting from Joss Hutcherson, you know, he pulls it off. He's upset. You know, he's like, no, she's not dead. You're lying. And then I sit back and I watch this and see how this plays out. Now, they have the same scene in here, of course, because this is supposed to be more accurate. And the child actor playing Jesse says, no, she's not dead. You lie. And I'm cracking up.
Oh, no. She's dead. Oh, no.
I cannot believe that just happened.
You lied to me.
The whole world lied to me.
You're tearing me apart, Lisa.
It gets even better, though.
The rope to her.
It gets even better. It gets even better. Later on in the film, in both films, the dad has to come to Jesse and comfort him and talk to him about, you know, because he's upset, saying, "Oh, it's my fault she died and whatnot." And again, in the film, they do a good job of pulling this off. In the TV movie, they couldn't have done a worse job. In the TV movie, he's got his face pressed up against his dad's stove, and it looks like he's acting because he's got his face all squunched up and you can't really see it. But his ADR comes in and is saying, then maybe I was the one who was supposed to die, Daddy. Because I was the one who let her die. And I'm like, no, you would not be hearing this. You would not be hearing this. What you'd be hearing is,
oh man. Oh no.
This is such a travesty. And I have it on DVD.
Oh my god.
That's wonderful.
I like the 2007 film. Do you guys see why now? By comparison? Yeah.
Could have been a lot worse.
Could have been a lot worse.
My goodness. That's true. Wow. I didn't even know this film existed.
Yeah, now.
Now I know.
Now you know.
For the 85 version?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just skip it. I can't tell if Leslie's supposed to be a girl or a boy in this.
Oh, my. You know, Leslie is a unisex name.
Yeah.
So God. Said, yeah.
In the book, they do discover she's a she. They do establish that she's a she, but you know, looking at it, the film, it's kind of, what are you, girl, boy?
Tomboy.
Tomboy, maybe. Okay.
Tomboy.
Could be both.
This is true.
Matt, you have a questionable fantasy film.
Okay. Yeah.
Yellow Submarine.
Yep. Now, just to clarify something, a lot of people may look at me and go, like, how the fridge is Yellow Submarine a fantasy film? Oh, well, wait, in a way...
Oh. How is it not a fantasy film?
Okay. Okay, I don't know. Like, Mike asked questions about me.
I know I did. I did.
Is
I was...
that the best way to look at it is that Yellow Submarine is a lot like Alice in Wonderland. It's that kind of fantasy where not a lot makes sense. And you know, maybe I could be exaggerating when I say this, but honestly, I feel like Yellow Submarine could be the perfect fantasy film in terms of how it established its world, like in Pepperland, because...
You're exaggerating.
Okay, let me explain. Because the world completely succeeds in bringing us to a place that we... that's unlike anything we could possibly imagine, where even down to the original logic doesn't even work. Like, I wouldn't be surprised if I go into Pepperland and, like, we're not even breathing in oxygen. Like, we don't need oxygen to live and stuff like that. But basically, a lot of people know Yellow Submarine as this kind of like a music video movie where it's all about the Beatles songs and stuff like that. But in a weird way, they kind of work in the movie pretty well, actually. Some, like All You Need Is Love and Hey Bulldog, they do coincide with what's going on with the movie. Sure, there are some questionable... like, there are some that maybe they don't really connect as much, like Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds or something like that, but you cannot deny that the strongest point is the animation. It is very clear. It is, like, it's pretty much, it's art in its own. That's the thing. It's one of the very rare movies that you look at it, and you can't really consider it animation. It's more art, because since it is released in 1969, during the height of the Beatles, this was when, like, this is pretty much also the height of pop art, back when... famous artists like Andy Warhol was pretty much big, and now the Beatles are coming in with this very unique art style. And some may argue that it looks cheap, but I did think about it that if you do give it the top quality Disney style, then it would lose its charm, because the look is very unique, it's very different, and considering that we're entering this world unlike any other, filled with weird characters like the Blue Meanie and Jeremy, it's just unbelievable. It's like perfectly a style of its own, even down to the point that it was a pinnacle moment in the Beatles' history. I mean, even at the end, like when everything is resolved and stuff like that, the Beatles themselves decided to go and make a cameo because they really enjoyed what was going on. Pretty much ending it off with singing All Together Now as a way to get rid of the Blue Meanies that are apparently in the audience. But yeah, overall, it's a very colorful, it's very vibrant, extremely imaginative movie. And a lot of people even claimed it as one of the greatest animated features, and I'm not going to deny it. It's such a beautiful film.
Yeah, it's kind of hard for me to, because when it comes to Yellow Submarine, I sort of make a bit of a mistake, I guess. I compare it, I make a mistake. Yes. The film could be a mistake, but my point being, when I was in my Beatles phase in high school, I started getting interested in their movies, Hard Day's Night, Help, and they had this very distinct formula. They were trying to be sort of a Marx Brothers-esque comedy, or maybe something, or with Help, it was more of a... It was more something like "It's a Mad, Mad World." I'm not gonna say all the mads; it's too much.
Yeah.
when it came to Yellow Submarine, the one thing left of the Beatles formula was using their music. Now they're not musicals. I do not think that the Beatles movies are musicals. They're music movies. Mm-hmm. Because the difference between a musical and a music movie is musicals, they sing songs. Okay. Hard Day's Night and Help, music movies.
Are you referring to jukebox musicals?
Yellow jukebox Submarine. Musicals. No, no. No, no. A music movie is when the music does... when the songs do not necessarily press the story forward.
Oh, so it's like if you just take that scene and it just works out as its own music video.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I can see that.
Yeah. When as you were discussing, when it comes to Yellow Submarine, the songs do play into the narrative. So I just bit myself in the foot there. But it's it is so weird coming off of those movies and going into this one. It's unfamiliar territory. I remember watching this in high school at a special screening over in San Francisco, and I kind of came out of it saying, yeah, it was creative and weird and fantastic, but I just did not know what to think of it, because I was like, Hard Day's Night. But yeah, one of my favorite jokes I've ever heard regarding the Beatles was a voice impression I once heard of John Lennon in Hell. He says, he's calling up the devil on the answering machine. He says, "Hello, devil, this is John Lennon. Yeah, I know it's good. I know you're kind of bothersome here, but you know what? I'm getting a little bit tired right now, rewatching my movies for all eternity. I don't even remember being a cartoon character, although the blue meanies do seem familiar. Anyway, have a heart, love."
I mean, it's just trippy. It's very psychedelic. It's that kind of fantasy. It has its own... It's probably in a subcategory somewhere in the fantasy films line.
It's somewhere in the same category with Alice, you know?
Right. So... it's something to, if you're a big Beatles fan, if you want to listen to their music and see crazy animation, it's worth checking out. But this is the whole point why I wanted to do this episode, is because of Malcolm's choice. Oh my god. Okay. So I asked Malcolm what he wanted to talk about. Oh my god. And when he told me, I was like, I wasn't too sure, so I had to ask these two guys for their, like, confirmed opinions on it. So I asked Matt and I asked James next, and I was feeding back off each other for a while until they started their own conversation. But he chose Kung Fu Panda, and he's like, "Is it a fantasy film?" And I was like, so Matt and James is just like arguing. It's like debating. It's like, what? So
yeah. Okay. So Kung Fu Panda. I mean, in of itself, it's a solid film. I mean, it is pretty much the archetype of the hero's journey, you know, someone starting from the bottom and, you know, gradually climbing their way to, you know, glory, to the top. And initially, that's what it was supposed to be. It was supposed to be a parody of that whole concept of the hero's journey. Now, why I consider it to be a fantasy film is because it's set in ancient China. So, I mean, it's already set in a classical era of Chinese history, where, you know, Kung Fu and the mystic arts are, you know, part of the culture. And it also deals with magic. It heavily deals with magic because essentially... ancient Kung Fu, like, they still had heavy beliefs in magic and, you know, incorporating their chi, which, you know, it's kind of like a gray area between spirituality and magic. But magic is involved in this film's lore because of the weaponry that was shown to us at different parts in the film. Like, there were different swords and vases that had different magical properties, So I mean, with all these aspects to take into consideration, I would say that, you know, Kung Fu Panda is indeed a fantasy film. Chinese fantasy, to be specific.
Yeah, we hit. Sorry, go on.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, we were trying to discuss about what exactly constitutes this as being this film being as a fantasy, and from where we were coming from, I argued that this if you view it from the point of view of Western culture, there is an entire subgenre of fantasy aside from everything that you mentioned. In literature, we like to call... Hang on a second.
Well, don't leave us hanging, James. What is it called? Already, you lost the argument because you quit!
You're a quitter.
In literature, we like to call animal fantasy.
It doesn't have to have any
magical elements whatsoever. It doesn't have to have magic spells or giant monsters. It could just be a very basic story of knights and bravery and swords and fair maidens, and have an animal cast. Yep. Because the precept of alone on the idea of an animal talking, that's pretty fantastic.
Yeah, like a Bambi would kind of be considered a fantasy. It is animal fantasy. Lion King. Robin Hood already is technically a fantasy, but. The Disney's Robin Hood definitely is a fantasy because, again, just all animal, anthropomorphic animal people, and the like. You're right about that. Kung Fu Panda, like the entire cast of characters, they're all anthropomorphized animal people, and that would constitute as, you know, animal fantasy.
Even though we don't technically consider the Roadrunner cartoons or something like that as being much of a fantasy.
That's true. Yeah, this is true. I guess there's just certain aspects of it that would, you know, constitute a film to be categorized as fantasy. But I mean, coupled with that, it's kind of like a catch-all that makes it a fantasy as a whole, as some of its parts.
Matt,
my turn.
Yes.
Okay. Uh-oh. In this discussion, I was, the one who was against saying that Kung Fu Panda was a fantasy. Now, keep in mind, I love the Kung Fu Panda movies. I'm excited for Kung Fu Panda 3 to come out. But here's the thing: in an animation standpoint, this is not considered a fantasy film. And that is because of the logic of the animal fantasy, in a way. Because, there is that subcategory of animal fantasy in literature. But when you really think about it, in animation, over 90% of animated features include talking animals. The examples that you bring up, Bambi, The Lion King, Disney's Robin Hood, The Rescuers, all those movies feature talking animals. But the catch is that they don't that's the only fantastic part of it. In a whole, they're not really fantasy movies in itself. It's just the cast are animals. And keep in mind that the use of talking animals or anthropomorphic animals or like ones that can talk and stuff like that, they have been used ever since the very beginning of animation. So that would kind of be taking the entire medium of animation and just putting that all in one category of fantasy, when, like, in reality, like, there's no way you can, like, by doing that, you can't really disperse it into other sections, you know? It's like, it's animation and it's fantasy. So, like, they're both immediately in without just making just animation into one. So, I get where you're going, that it is, like, out of this world seeing talking animals and stuff like that, but there's no way that seeing talking animals in an animated film, like, it makes it a fantasy. It is how it is. That's just how the medium works. And as with Kung Fu Panda, and as with Kung Fu Panda in itself, like, that, again, it is very debatable. Like, in a sense, Kung Fu, like, that, it's more about the arts of performing martial arts that are outside of your body limits that somehow you're able to do. And in a way, sure, there are those small little fantasy moments that happen, like, James brought up a few examples, like, exploding fingers, and, the skadoosh, and also when Master Oogway pretty much died and stuff like that.
It's a lot of mysticism involved in Kung Fu Panda. That's why I argue that it's a fantasy film. Not the fact that they're just talking animals, but there are very mystical elements involved in it, and the Chinese folklore. Like, there's like little callbacks to Chinese folklore. So,
I think what our argument boiled down to was that yes, we agreed that maybe the better way to describe this would be as a kung fu fantasy.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, my linkage, like, I said something in between the guys, like, okay, think of it as a martial arts fantasy film. Like, there's so many martial arts films out there that can contribute fantasy, you know, all the, you know, the moves and all the mysticism and all that stuff in there. Was just
Forbidden,
like,
Kingdom.
Let's do that.
Yeah, Forbidden Kingdom is a fantasy film.
Yeah, so there's a lot of Chinese lore and all that stuff, and the Chinese films, the Japanese films, you know, anything with kung fu or martial arts, that's, they have fantasy elements. And then Matt's like, wait, is the Karate Kid a fantasy film then? I was like, oh, no.
It's not set in ancient China.
No.
Unless you count those little drums they were playing in Karate Kid 2, you know? That little tambourine. Yeah. That was pretty magical right there.
That's totally fantasy.
Uh-huh.
I was like...
There's no way everyone in the audience could have had one of those.
Yeah. That is fantastic.
So, you think of it as like that, but they just went on and on about it. I was like...
I think we could, I think we just sort of broke bread at one point and said, okay,
yeah,
martial arts fantasy.
Yeah, oh,
even though it's more, it can be more martial arts technically than it is fantasy, but it's still...
martial. It's a martial arts movie with some fantasy elements.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yes. Yeah. Definitely has fantasy elements. I wouldn't say it's flat out fantasy, because I don't know if they, like, focused on, like, some kind of folklore, a specific Chinese folklore, then maybe. Because it wasn't like it was focused on any, like, specific magic or, you know, mythology. So, I mean, yeah, again, it's got fantasy elements in there, but still pretty fantastic.
Yes.
Fan-freaking-tastic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but at least at the end of the day with Kung Fu Panda, like, the argument about, like, if it's a fantasy film or not doesn't really matter, because at the end of the day, Kung Fu Panda is awesome. That's what it all boils down to.
Yeah.
It's pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, it was really good. Kung Fu Panda 2 was...
That was great. That definitely was great. It helps extend... like, the origins of Po, and also, like, we got more new characters, especially with Gary, Gary Oldman's character, like, as the villain, that guy was awesome.
That was fantastic, yes. Mm-hmm. It was also, like, it did tug on a few heartstrings, because, I mean, you know, with the whole, the assaults on the panda species, you know, you begin to feel truly deeply for Poe, because, like, you know, where are the rest of the pandas, you know? It's like,
wait a month, you'll know.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
And then Kung Fu Panda 3.
Yep. But we'll see what they do with this. I mean, DreamWorks, they were struggling for a while. I mean, Shrek, you know, was like their bread and butter as far as their animations go. And but when Kung Fu Panda came out, it kind of gave him a bit of a booster shot. And,
well, arguably, like, Madagascar also kind of lift them up a bit as well.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah. Even though I'll never understand the pleasure that franchise brings people. Yeah, at least they had the penguins.
Yeah.
No, the penguins is what killed them.
Really?
Well,
at least movie-wise... Okay.
I don't know. I enjoy the penguins the most, honestly.
Well,
out of all the characters.
Like, the characters are hilarious. No, but the movie... Well, that really hit the studio hard.
I have not seen the Penguins movie yet.
It's not as good as you think. Like, out of all the Madagascar films, it's the weakest.
Hmm. That's a shame.
Really, because I was so burnt out after the first one, I would take anything.
Because, like, the TV series, The Penguins of Madagascar, that was actually mildly entertaining.
Yeah,
but...
I've seen a few episodes of that, yeah. It was really decent.
All right.
It was funny, because... Before this podcast, I was like watching a random video, and all of a sudden the advertisement for the video was a Kung Fu Panda 3 related video.
Nice.
And it's weird because the video was a song parody. They were singing, Poe was singing something called Nunchuck Princess.
Nunchuck?
In the style. Princess.
Mm-hmm.
Just in the style of Jukebox Hero by Foreigner.
Nice. Huh.
She's a nunchuck princess. It's hilarious. It's god. I was like, oh my god, they're doing a Foreigner parody. I was like, funny. It was. I don't know. I'm kind of excited for Kung Fu Panda 3. It's like you get to see his real father, and you see all the pandas,
all the big pandas and the little pandas.
I'm stoked. I cannot wait.
Uh-huh.
It'll be the one January movie everybody's going to be excited for.
If you are, if you are going to the movies in January.
Oh, wait, it's coming out in January?
Yeah, it's at the end. January 29th.
Yeah, usually it's not a really good month for movies, apparently, but
well,
see how that goes.
It's a complex thing, because originally Kung Fu Panda 3 was supposed to be released in December, and then they realized, oh crap, Star Wars there, retreat. So originally they went into March, and then afterwards they were like, hey, you know what, let's do a little bit earlier, so they went with the end of January.
I hope it gets attention. I don't know, January is not... not the the ideal month to release movies.
Well, in a way, it's more close to February than anything, and usually some movies in February do well. Case in point, the Lego movie was released in February.
Oh, true, yeah.
So I think it's gonna do fine. I mean, like...
Yeah.
I mean, like, the only actual competition that it's going to have, other than Star Wars, well, like, it's either kids are going to go see Kung Fu Panda 3 or Norm of the North.
Oh, okay, well, Kung Fu Panda 3.
Yeah.
Yep.
Should be awesome.
Yeah. Have you ever seen Norm of the North is oh god, Polar Bear, Rob Schneider.
Yeah.
Rob Schneider is a polar bear.
I miss him as a hot chick now.
What has Rob Schneider done? Like, what has he done recently?
The Reef movies. Well,
he's got to come back in the Ridiculous Six. So,
well, it's on Netflix he's now. Back, if you want to check it out,
he's back being buddies with Adam Sandler.
Oh dear. Good for him. He's getting work.
Yay!
From Adam Sandler. He's doing all right.
Because let's be honest, where else? Oh yeah, Norm of the North.
There we go. Watch, it's going to take us all by surprise. It's going to get all kinds of Golden Globe awards and I don't know.
We're a little too late about that.
Oh yeah, that's right. Well, I don't know. The man's somehow getting work, and
I know.
I wish he would just, like, you know, try and not do an Adam Sandler movie. Maybe he has been.
Yeah, he had a TV show for a while.
Oh God, yeah, it was short-lived. That was Rob.
Because for a what? Really? What was it called?
It was on CBS for a while.
Hmm.
It was very short-lived. It was I don't even remember seeing it on TV. It was so weird. Because he has like a Mexican girlfriend. It's all about the Mexican family. It was just, in 2012. Wow. God, in January too, mind you.
Oh dear.
Rob. He played a former lifelong bachelor and landscape architect with a OCD who marries a knit-tight Mexican-American family, attempts to be closer to them, and often ending in disastrous results despite his good intentions.
Comedy ensues
with American-Mexicans?
Interesting.
It lasted one season with 8 episodes.
Sadness. For a while, I thought it was just, you know, Rob Schneider's and the Happy Madison crew that was, you know, holding back. I thought it was Adam Sandler and the whole Happy Madison crew that was holding back Rob Schneider. But now I think it's Rob Schneider that's holding back Rob Schneider. Because, I mean, he had a shot at doing his own TV show. It's like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. He does stand-up, too, once in a while. He's got stand-up special from a while ago.
I believe we were discussing fantasy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I know.
Yeah, we kind of went
completely off tangent.
Well, technically, we're thinking about how Rob Schneider could be good, so that's technically fantasy.
Touché.
I guess fantasy
Touché.
Is about being a good actor.
And, there's your opening sting right there.
Yes. I was going to ask before you guys went there is have you guys ever seen the Kung Fu Panda Legend of Awesomeness that's on Nickelodeon?
I have. Yeah, it's okay. I like it. It kind of gives us a little more like an inside look at the world of Kung Fu Panda. Like, there's more to it than just what happens in the movies. That I appreciate. It's kind of dumbed down.
For kids.
Yeah, of course.
It's for kids.
I wish they could have tried harder.
You have to appreciate the irony that the Jackie Chan impersonator they got for the TV show technically has more lines than Jackie Chan in the movies.
Yeah, who was that? Who did that? I know John DiMaggio's in this. He was voicing some character.
Give me a sec. He played Monkey, and the name is James Tsai, S-I-E.
Okay.
He also did the voice for Jackie Chan and the Jackie Chan Adventures.
Yeah.
Oh, that makes sense.
Okay. That makes sense. That's good casting.
And he was like, oh, I'm back. I can finally use my Jackie Chan impression again.
Yes, I got work again.
Yes. I can be Jackie Chan again.
Known as the Jackie Chan impersonator.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
All right.
Yeah, that is basically all that in the nutshell. Comment below if you think Kung Fu Panda is a fantasy film. Let the debate go on in the comments below, which people probably are not going to comment at all because it's a very underrated podcast.
I should.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks. Okay. Of course. Yeah, any final words about all the fantasies in the world?
Well, we still have a recording to go through.
My biggest fantasy is...
What's your biggest?
Is to voice in an animated feature film. So.
That's a really good fantasy to think about. Go for that fantasy goal.
It's while being dressed as a tiger.
It's the most realistic fantasy of all.
Maybe you voice a tiger in an animated feature.
While dressed as a tiger.
I have a little bit of a similar fantasy. It's mostly voice acting, but for the Disney parks, actually. Like, doing characters for Disney rides.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. I forgot about, there is a market for that. I just... I need to talk to my my agent about that, because that's something I've always been interested in getting into. It's like, doing voices for theme attractions.
Oh, yeah. Like, it brings out another level. Like, instead of seeing characters on screen, you see them in real life, so that's like an added bonus.
Yeah.
Something to think about.
Yeah, I probably better get going. Gotta... few projects that I gotta wrap up on my end, but I do appreciate you all inviting me on the show. Like, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, thanks.
No problem.
Yeah,
no thanks. Problem, dude.
Thanks for coming on.
Oh, it was great to have you, man.
Thank you. And who knows? Maybe we can do this again soon sometime.
Maybe.
Yes. Yeah.
Just gotta see what's in the cards.
Yes. Thanks. Thank you.
In case you want to come back, just let us know.
Yeah. Sure. Any topic.
Any topic.
Maybe fantasy films per two.
Yeah, fantasy films with Kung Fu Panda 2.
So.
Kung Fu Panda 2. Round 2 of our discussion.
Right.
Ding, ding, ding. Thanks.
All right. All right, you guys take care.
All right. See you, Malcolm.
Ciao for now.
See you. Ciao for now.
There, kind of, because the discussion's not over yet. I know Malcolm was in a very strict schedule-ish. Well, I know we started a little later, but that's okay. But the good thing is that our good friend Morgan Ledger sent us a discussion clip for the podcast for us to listen to and discuss itself.
Mm-hmm.
Which was a big surprise for me, which... Thank you, Morgan, if you're watching this. We still love you.
Yeah.
So, let me cue this up. And, of course, I'll play it on my phone, like I did last time with the stuff, so you can hear it through the microphone. And I can pause it anytime you guys want to. I can pause it and you guys can discuss. Otherwise, I'm going to play it. Just tell me when to pause it and you guys can talk over.
Okay.
All right. See if I can...
This is going to be an all-improvised one-take ordeal because, one, I have no script, and two, this is completely unplanned, and three, I kind of decided to do this for a variety of reasons. I'll probably get into soon, but, hi, this is the disembodied voice of Morgan Ledger.
Hi, disembodied voice. Yes, no surprise
here. Considering how we're talking about fantasy movies, and it's been a long time since I've been in this podcast, I have been unavailable for many reasons, which I won't get into for a variety of things. But no, I heard that you guys are doing fantasy films. I figured, I thought I'd throw my two cents of the ring on one of them. Because this is one that it's... Oh god, it's really bugged the ever-living crap out of me ever since I first saw it. And I just recently gave it a second watch, and I feel bad because part of me really wanted to like this movie. It wanted to at least, you know, appreciate and love like so many have.
Oh no.
Nothing came together for me. Just nothing came together. And I figured... excuse me. I just had a thing of tea. I do apologize.
You're excused.
Where was I? Oh, yes. So there were a lot of choices in terms of, you know, talking about fantasy movies. I already gushed over The Dark Crystal, one of my all-time favorite films, might I add. In fact, it's one very, very high on the list.
Right.
You know, I had some options. You know, what to discuss. But there was one that came to mind that still frustrates me. And if this was already talked about in the podcast, then, well, let me just start off by saying that this is from an entirely different perspective. So, you.
I'm going to pause it right there. We did not discuss this before on the podcast, and I think James knows what the movie is, but Matt, can you guess what the movie is going to talk about?
I know for a fact what it is.
Okay, I'm going to continue.
Perspective, so here we go. Now, this one, ever since the summer, has bugged me, because everyone loves it. Everyone praises it. Oh, it got a best award. It got an award at the Academy for, like, best animated feature. Oh, the critics say it's the number one film you must see when you're a certain age and appreciate. Oh, it's just beautiful. It's fantastic. So, why was I underwhelmed and fatigued? Why was I so disappointed when I saw Spirited Away?
Yep, there we go.
It still leaves me boggled. I still don't understand why I feel disheveled and perplexed every time I think about it. Well, okay, let me go to the start. When the film first came out, it was a big ordeal, of course. John Lasseter took it under his wing to make sure that it was treated with every single bit of perfection, manicuring it, treating it like it was the one greatest film. Because, of course, it's Hayao Miyazaki. He does great work. He did, you know, My Neighbor Totoro, Kiki's Delivery Service, Princess Mononoke, which got a great reception too, but for Spirited Away, it got mad press. It was like, okay, this is the guy that gave us this really good movie about the forest and a good environmental message. Now we got this movie here. Let's treat it just like Princess Mononoke. Let's really treat it like it's the granddaddy of all animated movies, and that's kind of the problem. For me, it seemed to be really overhyped for me. At least that was one problem in my jurisdiction. I remember seeing the trailers as a kid, and I had no idea what it was about. I really didn't. All I saw were images of a girl and these creatures and monsters and her going, Haku! And all those sort of things. And I sat back and I was like, it looks kind of interesting, but I don't know what it is. How can you be interested in something that you don't understand? So years went by, I had this whole anime phase where I just wasn't interested in anime and all that sort of stuff, and there was one certain thing that got me back into watching anime, and I'm trying to remember exactly what it was.
Waiting.
Oh well. I think it was in like my college years or something like that. It was some movie, I think it might have been Princess Mononoke. I can't remember exactly. It might have been, but regardless, it was an anime movie, or it could have been an anime TV show, one of the two. And I started realizing, you know what, there's actually more to this medium than just, you know, something like hyper-realistic faces and stretchy things, all that sort of stuff. Because don't get me wrong, I did watch stuff like Battle for the Planets and Totoro when I was a kid, so I did like that style, but then Pokemon came in and I just sort of stopped. I was like, yeah, I'm done with anime for this reason.
Mika?
Just how overly stylized it got. And with Spirited Away, the first time I saw it was actually this summer of 2015. I never saw it. All I know is that it was being highly praised. But every time I looked at it, it just, you know, from an adult perspective, when I saw the trailers and the images and everything, it just didn't look that interested. It didn't look that interesting to me. I don't know why. I couldn't understand if it was the images. I couldn't understand if it was everything in general. So finally, I saw it with two friends of mine, sat down, watched it. And by the time it was over, I was more glad that it was over than more glad of me actually seeing it. And I feel really bad because I know people really love this movie. I know people really enjoy this film.
I just want to add on to that a little bit. When we were finished watching this film, I remember it was kind of amazing because as soon as the credits were rolling, the Skype call ended. And it took me, alongside the other person that we were viewing with, a moment to realize that Morgan had just simply hung up. I thought it was... Morgan, if you are listening to this, I never said this, but I did kind of think that was a little bit rude at the time. But I understand after your reasonings, which you're about to get into, kind of why you did it. You can hit play.
So the movie is about this kid that is moving to a new place, which they really rush out in good old-fashioned exposition. Parents get lost, and they come across this little place, which they think is an abandoned amusement park, but it's really this massive little village slash recreational slash bathhouse. It's never quite clear.
It's a ghost town.
Like, you see these shops and booths, and there's this giant bathhouse, and it's like, oh, this is the big bathhouse that they go to and stuff, and I just sort of sat there and was like, they could have done more with it. And apparently these creatures go there to, of course, get pleasure and relax and eat, and I guess, freshen up and stuff, where they come from. Maybe I'm not that well endorsed into Japanese mythology, but whatever. Maybe they could have, you know, explained, you know, where these monsters are coming from. I don't know. Do they scare people? Do they live in the human world and look for a place to relax? It's never quite clear. I guess it's supposed to accept that these monsters live somewhere in the spirit world and they come here just to kick back and relax. So here's problem number one. The parents are idiots. They're just absolutely stupid. So the dad comes across this little place with this food and stuff, and he's like, oh yes, this is really good to eat. I don't mind if we, you know, munch on this stuff right here. Dude, first off, you clearly, you know, say this is an abandoned amusement park, and they're like, oh, you know, maybe it's open, oh, maybe there's, like, all this stuff here. Why are the parents stupid? I get the idea. Kids are smarter. Kids know better, but could you at least give them a little more of a brain? I am tired of this cliche. I'm okay with it on The Simpsons, because it's comedy, it's meant to happen, but in a full-fledged movie, you at least gotta have the elders... and I don't mean elders, I mean the middle-aged elders, the adults, at least have some dignity or respect. You don't just wander into ruins and just look about the place and be like, oh yeah, this is a great place to camp here.
Yes, you do.
So they eat the food, they turn to pigs, and then the girl, Chihiro...
Can I just add something to it? Now, the thing is with the parents... Yeah, some can argue they're not really the brightest, but, you know, like, looking back at it, it is what it honestly is what parents do, because in context, they're moving into a new home, and they want to go explore around, so, like, they want to see, like, what's going on around their new neighborhood and stuff like that, so they decide to go and take the time to take a look into this new, into this like this new place that seems to be an old abandoned abandoned amusement park. So like it the reasoning for the parents is more for curiosity and to explore their new boundaries because they're moving into a brand new place. And I know the old cliche of like, oh, kids are smarter and stuff like that, but I don't blame the parents. I feel like it does have a bit of context. Like, they're not just stupid. Because, like, when you go in, like, let's face it, if you're going to move into a new house, like, if you're going to move into a new place in a new state, like, you'd want to explore around without knowing what's going, like, without really knowing some of the context.
Mm-hmm. I guess so. I never really complained.
Turn to pigs.
Sorry.
Keep going.
And then the girl, Chihiro. Oh, good thing I remember her name, Chihiro. I hope I pronounced it right. If I do, I apologize in advance. Chihiro is stuck in this world, helping these creatures out. She goes under the wing of Yabubba. Yabubba. Sorry, Yabubba.
Yo, Bubba!
I'm sorry, it sounds...
Yo, Bubba! Over here!
Yo, Bubba, so funny!
I'm sorry!
Yo, Bubba, yo, Bubba, yo,
hey, Bubba. I had to ride you, Bubba, in order to get down here. I couldn't resist. So, the owner of the bathhouse reluctantly gives her a job. All the monsters hate her and stuff because she's human and they don't like humans, and it's that kind of prissy all over again. It was done better in Nightbreed, I'm sorry. Because you had that whole aspect of the hero's journey in there, and at least it was a clear narrative, and this whole acceptance of him between the human world and the world of Midian, and that was interesting, but that movie was meant for an older crowd. This is meant for family audiences. Okay, I'll give it some leeway if the monster designs weren't creepy. Seriously, all I remember is like this weird turnip-like monster with these two giant, pardon my French, schlongs on his faces and just looking all menacing, going, and I just sat back going, this is supposed to be whimsical and cute. The things that are supposed to be whimsical and cute look kind of cheap and very poorly done in comparison. There's like these duck-like creatures that we see at one point, and they just don't look that interesting. They just look like generic little stuffed dolls. There's this other monster who has like no face but a kabuki mask, and I guess the idea is that the more he sins and takes in pleasure, he gets bigger and starts eating people, and it's kind of uncomfortable and weird. There's this three-headed thing that jumps around and goes, oi, 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 oi. It's just really bizarre. There's this big baby, which, oh my god, is going to be the night terrors for years to...
Okay. I hate to cut him off in the middle of a sentence, but...
I should have timed it better.
Sorry. You're... I hope he's not making the argument here that the creatures of Midian were aesthetically pleasing. Because I thought that was some creepy shit, too. But I thought, in terms of comparing it to Nightbreed, I just sort of look at the fantasy aspects of both films and say, I haven't quite seen anything like this before. You know? It is weird. And yes, for me, that is where the whimsical aspect is. Yeah, this is something that has not been seen by American audiences, at least not very often, minus the dragon. That's pretty common in every culture.
Yeah, and I just need to add to this, like, when Morgan mentioned one of the some of the designs looking cheap and stuff like that, I was there like, I'm sorry, what? What are you freaking talking about? Because, like, the thing is that, like, yeah, there are some characters that do look weird and creepy, but that's kind of the whole point with Spirited Away, is, like, when you enter into the spirit world, that actually has a lot of Japanese inspiration and stuff like that. Like, when Morgan was talking about, like, the turnip monster, which is the radish spirit, like, it's more kind of a play on spiritual thing where it's pretty much, like, a food spirit and stuff like that. So, like, and that's where, like, you enter into the fantasy, because each of the spirits, they kind of represent something. Like, you got the river spirit when he came in, like, he looks, like, all gunk, and then he comes back, like, as this, like, really old man face with the body of a long snake and stuff like that. Like, in a way, I have to really disagree with Morgan on this, is that they don't look cheap. Like, they are, like, these are very creative designs where they bring you into this new fantasy world of all the different spirits and stuff like that. Yeah, they are weird. Yeah, like, they are weird. Like, even with No Face, where they try to, when he tries to fit in, but he doesn't really. Like, that's kind of the whole point of it all. And even, mm-hmm. like, with the characters, like, even all the other human-like characters, they don't look like actual people. They have a more reptilian look if you see them closely. Like, he just wants to find a place to belong and stuff like that. He just doesn't know how. So, yeah, I have to disagree with Morgan, is that, like, one of the biggest, like, strongest points is to, like, when you enter into this new world, like, to enter into the spiritual world of Spirited Away, like, it's with all these different characters and to meet them all.
Yeah, I guess we can continue there.
Yeah.
The way it looks so sinister, and the fact that it's nude and everything, it's
the baby.
Creepy. The thing is just completely creepy.
Baby had a huge ass.
The monsters can look interesting, but very, very sinister, but, you know, interesting at the same time. Using another tour de force, a family fair, Totoro and Labyrinth had this sort of thing where he's had all these, you know, weird creatures, but there was an interesting charm to it. There was something unique. I guess here they wanted to show the monsters as being, like, really brutal people, not very nice kind of beings. Again, the prejudice of the humans, and I'm done with that. Can we have something where, like, the monsters are trying to live in the human world or something?
Yeah.
Which we do, but I'll get to that later on in a moment. Oh, what else bothers me about this movie? Subplots and character motives are just really out of nowhere and weird. Like, there's this Spider-Man in the boiler room, which, again, as interesting these concepts sounds, they're nice designs, but something just feels off to me about them.
It looks like a tarantula and Dr.
There's this bit
Robotnik.
Where it's like, oh, if you go see this boiler man, you know, you have to, you know, keep asking him to get work and stuff, and he has these little mini suit-like creatures that throw coal into there, and they get rewarded with Lucky Charm stars. What? Anyway, then the boiler man, you know, is like, you know, I'm busy, I don't have, you know, much work down here and stuff. And then she's like, no, you gotta give me a job. And then one of the bathhouse people, which is a female, comes in, and she sees the human
Morgan, it's just the Figman from Twice Upon a Time.
Yeah,
and
really.
And the guy with the tarantula arms is just their version of Sonoma's Botch. Haven't you figured it out yet?
Well, at least there's no uncensored version of Spirited Away. It's like, I need a job. Wow, you know, tough little girl.
Tough shit, little girl.
I know you have mummies and daddies who have been turned into pigs, but so what?
Okay.
And then he's all like, oh, don't worry, just my granddaughter. What? Where did that come from? How did this sudden change of heart come into play? Okay, so apparently this bathhouse works in a very interesting way. Sorry, and if the audio for this is distorted, I do apologize. I'm trying to watch my levels so it doesn't come too loud or anything. So the way this bathhouse works is really interesting to me. They have males, they have frogs representing the males, and they have women cleaning and tending the thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't mean they're like, you know, women creatures or anything. That would actually be a little more interesting. No, they have these anthropomorphic frogs, one of them voiced by John Ratzenberg in the English dub, mind you. Because, of course, it's John Lasseter producing it. The English stuff, of course. And then women are, like, cleaning the place and everything. And I'm trying to, like, understand if this was, like, some part of context and stuff. And after researching it, it sort of is. And this is where it gets really uncomfortable for me.
Oh, boy, here we go.
The whole movie has this very interesting subtext about prostitution. And the fact that these monsters are, you know, going through here, you know, getting pleasure and all that sort of stuff, just washing and all that sort of thing. Seriously, there's, like, evidence in this scene where No-Face, like, offers her, like, gold coins and stuff, and she rejects it.
Perfect.
Yes. The scene where No-Face was offering her gold coins, the impression that I got from that was he was... You have to remember, in context, he was going crazy at this point. He was pulling this gold out of thin air and tossing it left and right. He was, and of course, consuming people at the same time. What he was trying to do, though, was win everybody's appreciation, and that's what he was in the middle of doing, and that's what you do when you... You throw money about. You're saying, oh, look at all the money I have. And that's what they were praising him for.
Yeah.
So when he gives her the money, she smacks it out of his hand and says, I don't want your money. But it doesn't mean that, hey, look, I wanna have sex with you right here and now. So let's do this. It's just saying, look at me, I'm rich.
No, actually, you know, I just had this realization. You know, like, you know, like, the best way to describe No-Face, he's antisocial. That's mm-hmm. the thing. He doesn't know, like, how to communicate with people and stuff like that. But the reason why he wanted to offer her gold and stuff like that, and why he really demanded Chihiro, like to really see Chihiro, is because she's the one who showed him gratitude. Like, she's the one who brought him in the house. Like, she was pretty much the first person to show him respect and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, so, I hate to... I know there's been an entire theory created around this particular form of subtext, and I don't mean to discredit it in any form, but this is just... You know, I think we're just here to explain, you know, what we got out of it.
Mm. Yeah, but exactly. I just want to just want a quick mention. I'm sure Morgan will continue about it, but the thing with the prostitution thing, I feel in a way, it could arguably be like in WALL-E, where like it has this message of consumerism, but the movie is not about like anti-consumerism and stuff like that, more in the same veins of how Spirited Away is not really about anti-prostitution, but you can see that there is a message there. If someone like someone would tell me that the movie is like the movie has like these subliminal messages about anti-prostitution, I'd buy it. You know, I'll understand. Mm-hmm. I get where they're going with it.
Okay, yeah, keep going.
and she rejects it. And he's all like, you know, no, I want Sven, I want Sven. And, oh yeah, I forgot to mention that weird thing about her name getting taken and changed to Sven. I'll get into that later. It's like part of a deal or something. But then, you know, he's like, I want Sven. And I'm just sitting there going, yep, prostitution. This is what I get for reading Red Lantern. And then looking into things too much.
You don't want to read that, trust
but
me.
But no, let's talk about that name change thing. So here's another nitpick I have, and also a bit of a problem. So the whole ordeal is that if you work in this place, Yo, Bubba. Okay, the owner of the place takes your name and gives you a different one in the form of a Japanese number. In this case, Sven. Sven.
Yes, she turns Chihiro into a reindeer.
If I remember correctly, the whole ordeal is that...
I know she's a super...
You can't remember your name. You go by this name. And at one point, she looks at her, you know, clump of old clothes and sees this little goodbye card that she got from people off screen, I guess from her school and stuff, that says, good luck, Chiro. And one of the allies, this dragon boy named Haku, says, this is very important. This is very important to, you know, hang on to, because you need to remember your name and stuff. And he mentions how important it is to hang on to the card or something, that I can't remember correctly. And I thought that'd be very interesting to play on to. What if Yabubba... what if the owner of the bathhouse found this card? What if she, you know, this was the only, you know, sense of identity she had other than her clothes and stuff? And I thought they would, you know, that'd be interesting if they did something with that. You know, Chekhov's gun. If you have a gun on stage, there has to be a purpose, has to be a point to it. There, you know, it can't just stay on stage and remain through the whole thing. No, there has to be a point and purpose, so it comes back later and is used. They don't do anything with it. I guess you could argue that the original clothes she has represents her identity, but that's a little too simplistic and basic. Come on.
Do they have to?
You know, even they look at that card, and it's like, okay, that's your name. That's very important. And it's like, that should be very important.
Okay, okay. Now, the one thing I have to say about the name, that, and I'm surprised Morgan didn't mention about this, but the thing with the name is actually something that links with the prostitution. Because when you decide... Because the thing is, like, and this goes with any form of prostitution, when you decide to go into this profession, rather it be to go into the streets and tell them to have a good time, or you go into a Japanese bathhouse, you have to change your name. So, like you don't, so like, when the people you interact with, they don't know your true identity. This is why... When you see, like, hookers and stuff like that, they're often they would be named, like, Diamond or Sparkle or Laquisha or something like that. So, and, like, at least with the name, and, like, when it comes to the name, like, she, like, yeah, sure, they don't really mention it a lot and stuff like that, but, like, they did, like, it is, like, a kind of a key thing. Like, at least she... We know that she has it, so she knows about her identity and stuff like that. And while, like, they didn't look into it a lot, but we know that she still has it, and we know that she still knows that she's Chihiro.
Mm-hmm. And another thing is, you know, we've established so far that she's... that she works in a bathhouse. Not all Japanese bathhouses offered sex. Not all of them offered sex slaves. If you worked at a bathhouse, you could easily have your name... You could easily have your name changed, and you would just be... a slave to the system. So, from there on.
That should be important, that little piece of paper in her hand, but no, they don't come back to it. Big lip alligator plot point moment. It goes nowhere. Oh, brother, that really annoyed me, because when you set something up like that, you gotta at least somehow make a reference to it later on. And it's like, oh no, they kinda do it because she has her normal clothes on, and she mentions this other twin sister that her name is really Sven. No! If that card means so much to her, why couldn't it just been a plot point? It certainly showed in that scene right there.
Morgan, you don't have to do this rant really in the bathroom.
Because I can appreciate it trying to be its own thing. I can appreciate it trying to be its own universe and all that. But it just feels like 2 hours of eye candy. And it's just weirdness on top of weirdness on top of weirdness on top of weirdness. My God, we have this scene where this monster, which they dub as a stink god, okay, in the Japanese, give me some credit, in the Japanese god, not Japanese god, in the Japanese dub, all the creatures are regarded as stink gods. In the American edit, if I remember correctly, they're dubbed as being stink spirits.
Mm-hmm.
So they have this giant monster with all this trash and glob and stuff, and it's revealed, oh no, wait, this is not a stink spirit. This could be something else. Spoiler alert. It's an allegory for a polluted river.
Mm-hmm.
So they have Chihiro tending to this monster covered in God, who knows how much sludge. And it's so disgusting and uncomfortable to watch. And I remember just cringing every time she slipped into it and stuff, and I'm just sitting back and thinking to myself, that's not mud, that is shit. This is a shit monster. I'm not even elaborating. There's scenes where you see, like, all the workers, like, holding their noses and really hyping up the fact that this monster smells and is awful, and I'm just sitting back going, I know why they're doing it. This monster's made of shit. It's a shit monster.
This is bringing back memories of this feeling.
Okay, in the movie's defense, the reason why... Okay, I understand that some people could say, oh, there's environment... Okay, it has a tiny bit of an environmental message there. But the reason why the river spirit exists is actually not because of an environmental message, but it's more because of Miyazaki's real-life experiences. Mm-hmm. There had to be at one point when Miyazaki had to clean out a polluted river, and at one point, he had to take out a bicycle. So, like, and that was one of the key things during that scene, is that Chihiro and everybody in there, like, one of the first things that they had to pull out was a bike. So, like, in its defense, it's not about the environmentalism, but more about, like, more of Miyazaki's personal real events that he witnessed.
I look at this whole scene as being a test for Chihiro.
Mm.
You know, it's like, okay, it seems to come out of nowhere, but if you look at it in the vein of the narrative, she's pulling her hours as a worker there. And this is just one of the things that they happen to do. This is her earning her keep.
Plus the fact that they gave her, like, the hardest job, because they put her in the most disgusting bathhouse that they just, like, had to clean off. They had to, like, no face is the only reason why she was able to get, like, good water to clean it up. And then suddenly she has to be in charge of cleaning the river spirit. Mm-hmm. So it was pretty much the ultimate test that nobody really expect her to pass.
Okay.
Ten minutes left.
Okay. I was about to ask.
Yeah, there's 10 minutes left of audio. Yeah, thanks for the long clip, Mario 2929.
Oh, I cringed. I cringed. And the scenes of the baby, I clenched. Notice how I said clenched.
I was a witness.
That thing is freaky. The little tiny face, the way it has like a grip on Chihiro and almost breaks her arm, and it's all like, you must play with me, you must play with me.
You must play with
me. No, you can't. You can't. You can't. Stop. And the thing with like Haku, like, I guess he steals, he's like the apprentice. Sorry, I guess he's like the apprentice or something, and like is cursed to be the apprentice and steal something from a twin sister that the bathhouse owner has, and he's like in dragon form and blood comes out of his mouth. It's like, how gory do you have to make it to be? I know it's like, oh, you prudes, you know, trying to hit back on the gore and stuff. There's sort of a limit. When kids see blood, they see blood. It worries them. They know this character's hurt.
And that could have been a PG-13, I guess.
You don't have to push it. He could have, like, had bruises and something, but no, there's, like, blood dripping out of his mouth, and it's all serious and stuff, and it's like, you don't have to push it that far. This is not Watership Down.
Yes, it is.
Oh, man.
Want to bet?
So, after all that weirdness, we get to the train scene, which people have been praising as the best part, because apparently it takes a break from the universe and everything, allows everything to sink in. I'm just sitting there going, what's this? What's that? What does it mean? Who are these shadowy figures on the train? Oh, look, what does that mean? What are they passing by? Is this the underworld? Is this limbo? Is this hell? Are all the ghosts on the train like dead spirits of people of the earth, and they're on this train going from one different thing to the next? Are these, like, does it transport, like, gods, these different underworlds and stuff? I don't get it. What's going on here? Who?
Try to time it
okay.
Right.
Okay. no offense, but overthinking it much? I think the best way to, honestly, I think the best way to put it is mostly when Doug Walker discussed this scene, because it doesn't have like this metaphorical message or anything. There's nothing to it, because it actually is just a scene where Chihiro goes on a bus. And that's pretty much it. This is exactly what people do in the bus. And, like, all the people around them, like, when they, like, they're all black figures and stuff like that, you know, that's how everybody persuades them. They don't necessarily have a face and stuff like that. So we don't necessarily recognize them, and we never will. They're just not.
I think you mean perceives, not persuades.
Maybe.
Yeah,
but then again, what do I know of grammar? Like there's nothing big with that scene. The reason why it's praised is of its simplicity, because it's Chihiro on a train, and that's exactly what happens when you're on a train. It's pretty much like after going through all that. Your mind just pretty much wanders off. You just look outside, you know. It's just a moment, you know, it's a moment for her to relax, and it was a moment for everyone to relax. And that's what it is. So, like, overall, just don't overthink it.
Mm-hmm. I got nothing else. I mean, pretty much what you said.
Gods, these different underworlds and stuff. I don't get it. What's going on here? Who am I? Who the fuck am I talking to? Why am I doing this? Why am I watching this when I should be watching something even better and brighter?
Okay.
This movie broke me. This movie really, really broke me. Not once, but twice. Mind you, I gave it a second chance. I saw the original Japanese dub last night.
And I'd just like to point out, Morgan, that's perfectly fine. But as far as I know, no one was asking you to give it a second chance. That's totally your choice.
And the original Japanese cut too, mind you, like the original Japanese is probably going to be, like, more different than the American cut, so...
No. John,
Really?
John Lasseter tries his best to stay as accurate as possible. There are no cut scenes or anything like that. It's not like any anime. John, like, as much as people criticize Disney for what they've done to the dubs, especially with Kiki, John Lasseter's mission was really to pretty much make it literally an English version of what the Japanese got. So there are no differences other than the dialogue.
All right. I was wondering about that because I dabble in anime a little bit, and I'm kind of getting into Miyazaki a little bit more, but I never deal the difference between the Japanese and
it's
English.
Just the dialogue, trust me.
Let's see.
Keep going.
Absolutely the same reaction. I kept looking at it and thinking, what is this? What's going on? Oh my goodness, this is scary. That's way too gory. And when I mean gory, I don't mean, like, bloody or anything. I mean, like, too much. Like, there's this bit where she, like, cures a monster by feeding it an herbal root, and, like, he starts running after her and vomiting and spewing all over the place.
No,
you don't need to do that! No! I get it! You can have him, like, get smaller and smaller and cough people up that he ate. You don't need, like, massive amounts of, like, gross globs and stuff, and there's this little bit where I guess he vomits on your bubba, and it's not funny. It's just, when you take into consideration that's
Wait,
like
is it supposed to be
guts
funny?
And grime in his inky stomach, even saying it right now, it just makes you feel uncomfortable and unclean.
Okay.
So, I'm still stumped. People say this is the best movie of all time. I don't get it. Is it because of the nice eye candy animation? Is it because it's an original story? There's been Alice in Wonderland. There's been The Wizard of Oz. There's been the whole concept of person going to a different world full of fantasy and wonder has been done before. But it's not the concept that makes it original. It's what they do with the concept. And here, I just didn't think what they did was interesting, or at the very least, unique. It was just weird and dark and creepy, and this is a place I don't want to go to. This is a place I want to stay away from.
You have my permission to stay away, then.
Technically, it kind of is.
A better movie, in my opinion, would be Wolf Children.
Oh, yeah.
Hands down.
Oh, that's a good one.
There's a narrative that's easy to follow compared to, like, the 10, 15 plot lines that happen in Spirited Away. Like, oh, there's this thing with the Snowface character. Oh, there's this thing with these twins. Oh, there's this thing with the kid who's really a river dragon and there's a spell he has on and needs to be broken. Oh, there's this thing over here with this big baby. No. No. Give me a simple, but if need be, do so complex, but make it a connects together story. Wolf Children was not like that. You had a character to root for. You had a story that was easy to follow. You had all these interesting things, all these interesting elements. And you wanted to see her, you know, succeed. She's raising these two kids that are half human and half wolf. And she has no idea how to raise them. And all the while, you're thinking to yourself, okay, what are the rules? If there's no rules with these kids, and she makes up the rules, you're wondering exactly if they're going to abide them, or whether they're going to find their place in the universe, and stuff like that. That, I found, was more interesting. Because she was fighting for something. She was giving these people a life. And at the end, when her kids go off in their different directions, you feel that satisfaction. If one of them even died in the film, you would feel her failure along with it. And there's all these risks, the people discovering them and all this stuff, and the fact that she's going all this way just to protect them and give them, like, a really nice childhood. That is more interesting. That is more fascinating. Why isn't that one the masterpiece? That really aggravates me. Instead, what we get? Oh, a movie where this kid just constantly is in fear and I guess trying to fight for her parents were complete bimbos, and, like, she is in tears a couple of times, and then, like, she, like, under reluctance, like, helps them out, and I guess midway she starts warming up a little and stuff. Boring. Dull. Been there. Done that. Smoked it. Wish I didn't have it.
Well, what can I say except exactly what I told you back then, Morgan? Not every movie is for everybody.
Like, I'll even admit, like, honestly, I kind of have a bit of a theory now, is that when it comes to Studio Ghibli films, everybody will at least have that one Ghibli film that they're not going to like, yet everyone else does. And, like, I've known people, they don't like Howl's Moving Castle. For me, I'm not too big of a fan of My Neighbor Totoro. I do understand why everybody loves it, don't get me wrong. But for me, it's just like, and also, like, the moments when you meet Totoro, they really are great. They really do stand out. They really are fun. But it's just that you don't really get that much into it. And I'm going to put this very lightly. I'm not that big of a fan of, what was her name? I'm trying to think. Let me think. Yeah, I'm not too big of a fan of Sasuke and Mei. I'm just putting it out there. But yeah, like, I do understand why people consider this a classic. Like, I could see where, like, people really do like it. For me, it's, like, I guess it's not necessarily my cup of tea. Like, I feel like that's more of a kid's film in Ghibli standards. But with Spirited Away, like, I guess, like, I definitely don't agree with a lot of what Morgan is saying about Spirited Away, but I'm not gonna go and make a total argument. I'm not the kind of person that's gonna go YouTube commenter on it, you know? Like, I'm just gonna leave him be with it and, like, move on to a movie. Like, we're just gonna go and discuss about a movie he'll actually like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a thing. Like, I'm the only one who has not yet seen Spirited Away, so I'm kind of, like, hearing both of your sides, and I'm just trying to consider if I'm willing to watch it or not. And that's the thing with other people's opinions. Like, not a lot of people will enjoy a film or like a film, and people are just have different opinions, which is what we do on the podcast. We talk about different opinions about what we like in film and what we hate in film, so I give Morgan props to his own gosh darn opinion on things.
Yeah, I can respect that too. I mean, there has to be differences of opinion. People are gonna like Tangled over Frozen, etc., etc.
Yeah, it goes on and on, so it's nothing new, and it's totally understandable, and I respect that. There is at least 3 minutes left, so let's see what he has left.
Okay. There's more?
You like this movie. Good for you. Good for you. I won't hold you against you. I really won't. If you like this movie, and you really believe it with all your heart, okay. Just okay. As for me, never again. Never, 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 never again.
Okay.
And just to make sure I don't end things on a downer, seeing the holiday seasons are coming across, I'm going to do something that I wish I did a long time ago for you guys. To all the viewers and everyone here on Cinema Royale, allow me to do a little something special. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, your troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. From now on, your troubles will be miles away. Here we are, as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends who are dear to us, gather near to us once more. Through the years, we'll always be together, if the fates allow. Until then, we'll just have to muddle through somehow. And have yourself a merry little Christmas night.
Fox out.
Salute.
Drop the mic. Yeah.
Thank you for that, Morgan. Thank you.
God bless you. So, yes, this is a extra long episode of Cinema Royale. It's really good because it's the winter finale for us. We're taking a little Christmas holiday break for 4 weeks, give or take, and we'll come back in next month for season 5 of Cinema Royale. 2016, our third anniversary year.
Mm-hmm.
Man, it's gonna be a hell of a ride. Thank you for watching and liking and enjoying this podcast. I have enjoyed doing this with these guys. It's a pleasure to do this with these guys. They do a lot of hard work with researching and talking about films with a passion.
It's what I do. What do you expect?
We have a lot of passion for film, and we just like to share it with people, and that's why I started it to begin with. Next time on Cinema Royale, we're going to dive into the first films of directors, directorial debuts. So pick a director and watch their first film, and we'll discuss it.
Alrighty then.
Since it'll be our first episode of next year, we figure we talk about directors' first films. What a good way to start the year. Yeah, thanks for Malcolm for coming on the podcast. He had to go early. Otherwise, guys, have a Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, all that stuff. Merry Birthmas, if you have a birthday in December.
Happy Birthmas.
Thanks for watching. Cinema Royale.
Ciao for now, and Merry Christmas.
See you later, dudes.
I have something to say. It's better to burn out than to fade away.